It's September, and we're having margaritas on the patio.
Yes!
Yay to late summer. Okay, welcome to Flying for Flavor. We had an amazing week this week with weather-wise, so I sent a message saying, Rita's on the patio this week.
I am so happy. And today was a Rita's on the patio. Actually, it was at a girlfriend's, teaching her how to make chili.
Okay.
Carne, which is actually funny because now we're here for tacos.
Tacos.
And we had a Rita earlier today, and we ended up taking it out on her lounge as well, going, let's take advantage of it while we still can.
I know. So and that's the whole thing is I've been basically in my little dungeon of kitchens or whatever for most of this week, so I haven't really been able to get outside and enjoy the weather. You can even put that down if you're finding it's in the way, hiding your pretty face.
Look, I'm here.
Okay, so one of the cool things, we're at a place in Sudbury called Tuco's Tacos. So it is not just a cool little margarita Mexican food place, but it is all vegan. So as much as I am a fat and meat lover.
We know that I'm a hardcore carnivore, yeah.
Yes, I actually really enjoy it here.
So good.
It's so good. It's one of the hot spots. They even have a little food truck and stuff. They have this cool little funky patio, but you can get all your Mexican favorites done in a vegan style. So you're not really feeling like you're missing out on stuff. So it's a great place. The patio's cool with all kinds of movable chairs and stools and everything else.
It's really cool. And you can get good margaritas here. It is, and good tequilas. It's not just Jose and... Sauza on the menu. They've got a great selection of top shelf tequilas as
well. So it's like top shelf place, exactly. So before we get to her thing, I just want to explain what we were doing. So usually around this time of year is when I do my season 3 launch, because we usually time it around my birthday. But this has been one hell of a fall season for me, which I'll explain in a bit.
Summer and fall.
So just to make things a little smoother, we're actually going to push it back a couple of weeks. So we're still going to have, I figured out another 2 episodes that we're going to have after this before we do season launch.
We're going to do the launch in time for my birthday.
Yes, exactly. See, it's going to, every year we're just going to keep alternating.
Deal.
Okay. So before we get started on all the serious venting, Cynthia, do you have any WTAFs this week?
Do I ever. And it kind of came from shopping with my daughter-in-law, which is what we call my son's girlfriend, and trying to find them clothes, and specifically clothes that kind of were longer than their bum. And it reminded me of all these times I go into bars and into restaurants, and the servers, their dress code is to wear like a short skirt or a skirt. And I am a bit of a prude. I think that your skirt should cover your vagina. So
being such a prude.
And I've been talking to a lot of moms of teenagers.
Because that becomes a belt.
Right? It's like a chastity belt that isn't quite finished. And the challenge is that literally I'm watching, you know, girls walk into school, and also these are the same girls that are serving tables, and I'm afraid that if she turns the wrong way that I'm going to get a full-on snapshot. Like, it's just so gross. So here's the thing. If you want to make some money, the tatas are great. Like, you can get them kind of all lowered in and a little bit of this without fear of getting any, like, bodily secretions in my food.
So what I'm thinking is that, so we like to always sort of create a suggestion, positive suggestion.
Out of my with actual facts.
So what I'm going to suggest is that we do a, there is no mandate, there's no employer that's going to say your skirt isn't short enough.
Exactly.
So as long as it's probably above the knee, you can get it like a pencil skirt, I think is actually hot.
Fingertips are good.
And
fingertips
are good. I remember back, do you remember the old Marymount days?
Back when we were in all girls school and it had to go to the end of our fingertips.
And I used to roll it up underneath my skirt. So.
But our vajayjays were not hanging out.
No,
and
there were some girls that were, but that's
where I'm going with it. Is that like short skirts are great. Short skirts are sexy. But honestly, if we have to worry about whether or not your vagina is going to end up on our table, the skirt is too short. So I'm going to encourage servers, bartenders out there, and I'm not just picking on girls. I mean, it'd be the same thing if we had a guy in a skirt and like the front bits were hanging out. It still wouldn't be cool. Keep those bits covered, because a little bit of like secrecy or a little bit of like mystery is way sexier than having it come out in the middle of the meal.
Same idea with the shirts that are undone down here.
That's what I mean. That's like a little bit of girls is all right, but having the nipples out, not sexy.
Not sexy. Rant over. So I think, I don't know if we touched on that, but we did that one episode, was it last year, where we were talking about girls in the industry. I don't remember. Yes. I don't think we talked a whole lot about it.
We didn't get into the sexy uniforms at all.
No, because it is still a mandate for a lot of bars and restaurants. A lot of the chains do require. So there's, I mean, I'm not going to name the chains that are here in town, but there's a few of them that it's a big running joke now that the guys in town go to these particular bars
just to see
because of the girls and what they're wearing behind the bar.
Which is interesting because, I mean...
And it's not a Hooters.
I worked at a local establishment years ago. I don't want to say how many because it'll make me cry. A long time ago. And quite frankly, the style at that time was like jeans and like cowboy boots or jeans and like... Mm-hmm. Okay. It was the late 90s. And we had V-neck t-shirts. V-neck t-shirts, a pair of like bootcut jeans and boots, and I'm telling you, I did very well. You know, I didn't have a whole lot of cha-chas at that point either as well, but I mean, looking good, and quite frankly, you're gonna make more money with your personality.
And
I know that sounds lame,
and you know what?
But
and
it's
doing
true.
A good job.
Right?
Because if you can't bend over to pick something up, if you can't carry a tray, if you can't actually properly perform your duties
because
as
your
a
skirt
server,
is too short or your boobs are hanging out.
Correct. Or you're just, yes, all disheveled.
Or uncomfortable.
Falling out of things. Then that could actually inhibit some really good tips. So.
And I'm telling you, as an old broad who still bartends, I did gaming tables last night. A well-timed joke and a little bit of ribbing and back and forth. It was myself and actually my son's girlfriend was on the other table. And we had a blast and we did really well because we used our personality as opposed to, I mean, we did red lipstick and earrings on, but that was about the extent of our sexying up it for this particular event, so. So, tell me, Steph, how has your last 4 months been?
Okay.
What you been up to, my friend?
Okay, I've been getting asked a lot, and also because this week I've been catering for Cinefest, our international film festival here in town. I've been doing it for years, back when I had all the catering days, and then I stopped for quite a few years, and then they wooed me back last year because it was their 30th anniversary. So I said, okay, I'm coming to do the 1 year.
And we're back.
And we're back. So this year I said, oh, you know, it'll be a good promo because I have projects coming up in the fall and that'll help promote it. So I thought it was going to be all working out. So needless to say, I mean, it's still working out great for this week, but I'm still getting a lot of questions and asking it about it. So I wanted to, for those of you who are listening and watching and those who saw previous posts of mine, I figured now's the time to kind of share this.
You can share it.
All right.
Da-da-da!
Okay, so back in April, this is funny, this is September, so in April, my husband and I decided that we were going to purchase a building in downtown Sudbury. Now, one of the reasons we did that is because it's always been a sort of dream of mine that I always wanted a teeny weeny little wine bar, similar to you would see in Italy or in Spain or something, just a place for people to go for drinks after work, have a couple snacks, catch up with people after work, maybe on a Saturday afternoon. Like, I wanted some place that was not an overly formal big sit-down place, more of a social, relaxing, a place you can still go, though, and have a glass of wine and an appetizer before you go to a big charity event and not feel out of place because you're wearing a nice dress or something.
Because you're not wearing jeans and a t-shirt.
And we are lacking in this city of upscale places. Everything's super casual like this, which is great, but there are some occasions where you want things to be a little upscale and we just don't have them anymore. So I always had this plan. I had business plans worked on. I had things going on off and on for years. And then this building came up for sale. Okay. And so one of the reasons I like this is also because we had always talked about at some point kind of downsizing from our big house and then having a, it's kind of downsizing because it's just the two of us and we're never home anyways. And then eventually having almost like, instead of having a place in Florida, everyone likes to retire to Florida, I want to have places in other countries. So the plan was we're going to have a small place here, maybe a small place in Spain, a small place in two or three other things, and then we would lease them out through Airbnb. Don't laugh. What are you laughing at?
Because, you know, I'm going to have a place in Spain, a place here, and have a place in Sudbury. I love you.
I know, but I'm just working on it.
I know your plan. I know.
So it's also supposed to be an income-generating thing.
Yeah.
So that we're actually leasing it out through things, like, especially with this Airbnb, wasn't around years ago. So having that as an option would be a smart move.
that would provide the income to pay for the place.
Yeah.
And then we would just block it off when we were on to go, and we'd have our own place to stay as opposed to staying with hotels or other Airbnbs. So, pardon us, we're eating vegan nachos, which are really good. Okay. So, one of the things we liked about this building is not only did it have a space for the wine bar, it also has another business.
Wait, it has space for what?
The wine bar. Did I mention the wine bar?
You didn't mention what you're doing with that building.
Oh, okay. That's what I talked about, the wine bar. So that's what I said. It's always been a dream of mine to open the wine bar. So the wine bar will be downstairs. It's beside an existing successful hair salon, which will provide some income to help pay for the mortgage. It's a great investment opportunity. And then we have two rental suites upstairs, which are already fully furnished, that were actually done by family friends originally a number of years ago. And so this way I'm going to spruce them up, change them up a little bit.
Yes. Yeah. And how has the journey been to open this wine bar? Has it been smooth, Stephanie?
She knows.
I'm just laughing because
she knows I've been a little bit stretched and cranky.
A lot of us foodies have this dream, right? We all kind of have that plan in the back of our head, or even, you know, in the back of our computer. This is what our menu would be, and this is how it would look, mm-hmm. and this is what we want to do. And many people who are wannabe entrepreneurs have this dream, but the reality rarely looks like what you expect it to be.
So, and that's where my story takes a little bit of a detour. So it started off, so we had this great thing, income property, price was good, the building's in great shape, had the original inspection done, everything's ready to go, had a closing set for August the 1st. So I had it all planned out, I already went and ordered a bunch of stuff, I've got stuff in storage units, everything's ready to go. 2 weeks before, I think it was 2 weeks before we were closing, we got a call just prior to the final fire compliance. So I'll go through all the steps.
Oh, and we signed, I did it, but you signed the papers during our PEC event.
Correct. So you didn't see that part. So when we were in Prince Edward County drinking at the bar, at the brewery, in between taping that, some of those clips, I was actually signing the paperwork for the purchase of the building. So we still to this day do not own it yet, which is funny after all this time. So there's a lot of little steps and loopholes. So at the time we found out that I guess, and it was not the seller's fault, and it's not the people he bought it from. The building was personally built in 1965. At that time, whoever registered it and got the original building permit only listed it as a commercial property. So Airbnb and these short-term rental things are new. So at some point after 1965, whoever owned the building all those years ago decided it might be a better idea to change the upstairs into apartments. They just never told the city they did that.
Oh!
And that you can't do.
Mm-mm.
So it's one of those, and Norm had a really great explanation for it. So as you know, you cannot drive a car without a driver's license, mm-hmm. right? If you happen to leave your driver's license at home and you're driving around, you're performing an illegal act.
Yep.
However, it's only until you get caught that you get fined.
Right.
Right? So this is the same idea.
This building is all these owners,
all these, yes, it's been passed on from owner to owner after all these years, and even through the buying and selling and everything else, it just so happened that nobody asked the right questions, nobody asked anything, no one said anything. It's not people were hiding things. People just assumed because the apartments have been there forever.
Yeah.
Since the 60s and 70s. So now, because they need to go from one zoning to another, you can't just change it on a piece of paper. Doesn't matter how good a condition the building is, because we have no physical changes having to be done, but everybody needs to inspect it, everybody needs to sign off on it, and it might be different depending on where you're listening from, but here in Ontario, there's a Ministry of Environment, anyways, they all have to sign off on things, and they have special rules and mandates for what somebody can sleep in, whether it is you sleep in it for one day as like a hotel or where you sleep in it for whatever. So I wanted to share this to keep in mind for anyone who wants to do Airbnb stuff. Your insurance requirements are different.
Mm-hmm.
So especially if you're renting it out, all of a sudden now you have guests and everything else, so your contents and other insurance will be changing. But I went through all of this and go through it, and it's been, because of the original inspection, then they have to do what they call a phase one inspection, which requires an environmental engineer to pull reports from, not just since the building was built, oh no, it is to pull reports from, I think Norm called it, from Queen's time. In other words, as long as there have been records for that area to make sure that there are no contaminants. And I get that.
What's so mind-blowing to me is that even with the commercial building,
mm-hmm.
that that stuff doesn't already exist.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
And it's not like it's the only building downtown.
Mm-mm.
And there's in the downtown Sudbury. I mean, Sudbury's been a city in the downtown core for so many years, pretty
much
a century now.
We've had buildings torn down and rebuilt, torn down and rebuilt in that space.
Correct. But whether they were residential is the key. Mm-hmm. So it all has to do with people's safety and they're sleeping in it and everything else. So I get that part. So that's been sort of stalling that. So the suites were stalling it because we're basically, as a seller and the buyer, we're sitting around waiting for reports, and then it'll always be next day, it'll be next week, and then it's another week, and then, oh, we have to wait until we get another report back in. So anyways, it's just been a little bit of a chaos. So just to show you some of the problems that can happen. So it started off, so it's been, we're 2 months behind schedule already, and I just found out the other day that it's now going to be a possible 6 to 8 weeks again.
Until you can occupy those units with Airbnb. Well, take over in general to have them be
exactly
rentable.
So even if you wanted to rent out, let's just say you have an office, small office building, and you think, oh, it'd be kind of cool, like this, you know, I can take part of this, turn it into like a little studio apartment and rent it out, whether it's short term through Airbnb or it actually has an apartment, that's considered change of use.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden now, all of these permits, inspections, everything else comes into play. So I've learned a lot over the last little while about all this. But needless to say, we are going to kind of put the suites on the back burner. However, I made a note of all the things that as a result of this. So I wasted money on the promotions. So I paid for...
Because you created and started getting... You were ready to promote like 2 months ago.
Yep. So I was actually ready to start taking reservations for the suite starting August 1st. Because
you're supposed
August
to take possession
5th,
of it.
After the first week, right? Because the suites were already furnished.
Mm-hmm.
Aside from me doing some cleaning, changing on a couple bits of furniture, changing bedding, towels, all that kind of stuff, they were ready to go.
Mm-hmm.
So I had already created a website. I already did some promotions through Sudbury Tourism, and I'm in their fall and winter guide for accommodations. I already started doing some online stuff, of course, with Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. I had market materials produced. I also had storage for all, I've already purchased all of the additional furniture, other things that are going in the suites are all in storage right now, so I'm paying monthly storage. Fixtures, that kind of things, bedding and any equipment for two, these are two full size
apartments.
One bedroom suites, like they're massive. It's not hotel room size, like these are huge. I forget how many square feet. I can't remember offhand.
But they're basically one bedroom apartments.
Correct. You know, and right, they're on the second floor. Anyways. When I do open them, they'll be great. But, so one of the things is because I was expecting these, as soon as we take possession of a building, you want to start creating income right away. And I knew that we weren't going to have the wine bar ready to open, like, right away.
Mm-hmm.
So the key thing to get income coming in was going to be these suites. So by having them on, listed on Airbnb, right off the bat, I could start getting bookings and stuff right in throughout the summer and then into the fall. Well, I've now had to cancel three large reservations, four, because one of them canceled on her own. So they don't like cancellations.
No, I didn't know that.
So this is one thing you have to be prepared for. So there is a section on there that as soon as you set up an account for Airbnb and put all your information on it of the property that you want to, space that you want to rent out, they start hounding you with, like, you're going to list it now, you can list it, you're going to make it live. But once you do that, immediately people start seeing it's a new place. It shows up on if they're doing search results as a new place, a new listing. And
so they promote it well, which is good.
Which is great. But if you start promoting it and people book it, even if you, as soon as they actually book it directly, because Airbnb, it's not like they're applying to book it and then you're saying yes or no.
They book it.
They book it. So they book the place and now I'm being told, okay, well, you're not, we have to sign an amendment to the purchase and it's not going to be for another 2 weeks. I have to message somebody, like, I'm really sorry, like, right now, I can't say for sure whether I'm going to have the space and time for you to come in. It's up to you and whether you want to take the chance. So one lady actually canceled on her own and went someplace else. It was cute. Her answer was, she goes, so do you have any other properties in town? I'm thinking,
aww.
No, honey, I'm not a real estate agent. That's not me. So, and then the, but another lady, she decided to gamble and wait to the last minute. So I had a very... they call a flexible cancellation policy, which is like 48 hours before. And even then, she didn't want to cancel on her end because she didn't want to get dinged any kind of cancellation fee or note on there that she canceled last minute. Because I guess it does affect your profile. So she made me cancel on my end, which is a $50 charge off future thing. So it's $50, it's $50. So unless I send in paperwork to Airbnb to basically prove to them that it was out of my hands, the city just won't let me.
Which you're going to want to do.
Which I've got paperwork for it. But in the meantime, I am no longer allowed to go to superhost status for probably a year now, which some people actually only look for spaces that are superhosts. You can see our previous, I'll put the link to the previous Airbnb listing so you know on that.
Because that's one of our recommendations.
Yeah, and there's also now an automatic review, just like you would have regular reviews.
Yeah.
It's a review that shows up on your under your reviews now saying that you canceled on somebody. So I've now canceled 3 times. So it's like canceled, canceled, canceled. So now when someone's looking at my space, they're going to say, oh my God, she keeps canceling on everybody, right? So bad form. So the only way for me to remove that is I basically have to start paperwork and start a process with Airbnb to fight that back. So just so you know, if you decide you want to rent out your room in your place or whatever else, those kind of things are you just taking a chance and renting it and then canceling on people last minute, not a good idea. So I've had a lot of discussions back and forth. And by coincidence, a lot of people who were booking through me are all new to Airbnb.
Interesting.
And as much as I've never hosted before, I've rented a lot, but they were asking me how to do things.
Right.
So they didn't know either. So that was that. So then don't forget about insurance, of course, as I mentioned that. But there's also banking fees. So I had to set up a new bank account for the suite. So now I'm paying monthly banking charges for a business,
that's not existing
yet. And not to mention just general loss of income for the upcoming holiday travel season. Right?
Well, especially, over, because we've got a really active film community here in in Sudbury, so there's many opportunities there with TV shows that are filming and Lifetime movies and that kind of thing. So it's not just the holiday, but just even those opportunities that are ongoing all the time here in Sudbury that you're now missing
out
on.
Correct. So now it's just sort of standing, they're sitting there empty, which is sort of frustrating. And then, not to mention, there's lack of other income because this is the time of year I usually do classes.
Yeah.
I used to do a lot of classes starting end of August, September, October, and I didn't book anything for these
because
months.
Because you expected to.
Because I expected to be so up to my eyeballs and the other stuff that I didn't plan anything else, so I had no other income coming in. So that was kind of suck for that. So that's a lot of the fun stuff. That's the sad part of the story.
So that's the kind of like buyer beware.
And and that's just especially for the Airbnb thing because this short-term travel thing. And one of the things I came across here in Sudbury, we have a hotel tax. Mm-hmm. So I had to keep in contact with that department in the city because don't assume that they all talk to each other because I'm not collecting. But needed to let her know that we have not still taken possession of the building yet. So that means the current owner, the seller of the building, is still responsible for sending in his forms every month. So anyways, we decided that we're going to, we talked to the seller. Luckily, we have a good rapport with him now that we're just speaking directly to him. He really wants to sell the building. We really want to buy it, but the city just won't let us take
it. It's just crazy.
We just can't do it yet. So the issue is that I don't want to put off opening a bar so long that I end up opening it during a quiet season. And for anyone who knows the restaurant and food industry, January and February are hell.
Before you jump to the next part, which is my favorite as well too, because it's more into like, again, the opening of a bar, restaurant, that kind of thing. I actually had a conversation with a local entrepreneur last night, and because I did not ask her specifically if I could share her story, I'm going to keep it as vague as I can so it's non-identifying. But again, it's the ideas of when you go into business and you know everything about your business. So I'll pick on myself. I'm a wedding planner, event planner.
Yep.
I know events, I know hospitality, I know bringing people together, I know helping create a space where people can have a good time. I know, you know, the food, the entertainment, all that kind of stuff. I know that. Luckily, I have a background in business and a background in helping other people run their businesses. But most people who go, or a lot of people, I shouldn't say most, but a lot of people who go into business for themselves because they are chasing their passion and they're pursuing their passion as a career. They know their passion, they know their craft. But when you get into the business side of things, it's a whole other animal. And I know that you're gonna go through some of that specifically for the bar. Mm-hmm. This particular individual had rented a space, and 3 days after they took possession, the owner of their building declared bankruptcy.
Oh my God, I don't feel so bad now.
They had just provided this owner with a check for 6 months' rent and had a 3-year lease. So the amount of issues that this owner has then has had outside of like the business itself and worrying that their business model is going to work, but dealing with the building and dealing with the other tenants who also don't have a, and dealing with these other occupants who don't have a property manager. And you know, she's been banking her rent for this whole time because there's no one to collect it. But at some point, someone's going to want to collect that rent. Yep. You know, like all these things that this is not an uncommon story. So I'm, as the one who's going to stir the shit a little bit more than Steph will, I'm wondering, is this a common thing out there? Like, do we have viewers who've had similar issues with their own cities, their own red carpet, their own red tape? Like, is this a thing that just when you're, it's very scary for anyone going into business to think that there are so many barriers without it being about your product or your market or any of the marketing side of things.
Correct, and I think it's one of those things that, I mean, here in this city, there's always people complaining about the red tape and all the bureaucracy part of things when it comes to being a business-friendly city. I've also talked to people in other cities, and they complain about their cities in a similar way. So I think it always, I think a lot of it stems from, this is just my opinion, lawsuits, insurance, liability. So there's a lot of protections that have to come into play. So as an example, you know, even catering for the film festival, there's like health unit requirements, there are forms they have to fill out. If there's liquor involved, there's other insurance stuff. The insurance company needs to know if it's something, it's a special event that's there. There's just all these other steps. And it's basically to sign off that, okay, if something happens and someone gets hurt, sick, or whatever.
We've covered all the bases.
Yeah, so everyone's covered for it. And that this way the city's not liable, the property where we're holding the event's not liable, like, right? Everybody wants to make sure that they're not at fault. Yeah. So a lot of that. And then all it takes is one person to get sick, injured, or whatever. And it might have found one thing that, oh, we never thought of, like, looking in and protecting that. So now there's another rule that gets added. And I have to admit that sometimes the rules are just silly because there's, like, no wiggle room.
Yeah.
Because there was one bad scenario.
Yeah, one person once, you know, got a tummy ache.
And then everything gets changed, right? Mm-hmm. So, same thing with health unit requirements. I'm not going to do an entire show on just a health unit.
Yeah.
That's another show.
So I just wanted to share that because the idea that regardless of what kind of business you go into or what, you know, say your specific experiences certainly aren't only to you, like other people
Correct.
Are struggling.
I mean, and I opened when I had my catering business, my catering kitchen and business was actually in my home, which is a whole other set of loopholes and everything else because I have to be zoned for it. I can only have so many employees. And that's just our city bylaws. Otherwise, people would be opening up all kinds of restaurants in residential areas. I had to get health inspections just like restaurants do. There was all kinds of other steps that I had to do as well. And so it's one of those things that I was familiar with that part, and I've leased a space for my catering place before, but that was a weird situation because I actually leased a space within a college, which is a whole other...
I remember that. That's a whole other story
again. And then with Ministry of Education and a college property, which is unionized, that's a whole other book. I'm really good at reading leases now, though.
I bet.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So wine bar. What's the wine bar called?
Oh, it's called Wander. But I'm gonna put links and stuff to it. I mean, you can peruse the. I haven't really done much on the website because I've been sort of just putting my head down and feeling. Feeling cranky.
I've been working on all kinds of stuff in the background that she doesn't know about, so it's all good.
Okay. The fact that he knows it's YouTube, it's kind of cool.
We are.
I am. Flying for flavor.
Flying for flavor?
Mm-hmm.
Cool. What's your
name? Mm.
Are you
YouTuber?
Don't touch anything.
I was
going to
be a
YouTuber.
Yeah, sure.
Come say hi and wave. Say hi. Say what your name is.
Hi, my name is Taylor and I had a kidney transplant.
Taylor is a local celebrity.
Oh,
we have all heard your amazing story, Taylor. I'm very honored. My name is Cynthia. I'm very honored to meet you.
We're so excited that you're going to be on our show. And then he's gone.
Would you mind? We could share the link if you want to all of the stuff that you've been doing.
Yeah.
And we'll share it and promote it. Because you guys really are heroes. Like, it's, I know you're just living your life and it's really, really difficult, but we appreciate what you guys are doing.
No, Taylor.
Right. When you're finished, go ahead.
So, I've been in the hospital for lots of times. to make. I was trying to go on YouTube, but my mom doesn't like bad words on YouTube. So if I see a bad word, Mama screams like at me, like I love.
Absolutely.
You really gotta watch YouTube, I tell you.
We do the same with my kids. So, I get it.
So.
You'll have a YouTube channel of your own soon.
I see it coming.
Yes.
So maybe I'll probably like where do you live?
I live here in Sudbury.
Okay. So maybe I'll come to you guys' house and do some lots of videos for you.
That would be so fun.
That'd be fantastic.
So
especially when I don't want to do anything, then you can do it for me.
Yeah. And it's a honor to be with YouTubers. I'm like so happy. Like, oh, those are YouTubers. And I'm like screaming. And you watch Funnel Tim? Whatever it's called.
Oh. Do I watch what? Oh, this is the microphone. I'm just making sure everyone can hear you. It's okay.
So, I'm probably gonna be here because my mom went here and I was crying at home because I really wanted to come here because
we do too.
And this is a fancy place,
it
but
is.
It's fancier inside.
Mm-hmm.
So I love this place, and YouTubers, even Marshmallow, please sign this video.
Because
I love you, and you're the best DJ.
Love it, buddy.
Okay, sign off. Say signing off now.
Say sign off. Tell everyone bye. Say I'll see you later.
Bye.
Next week. Bye.
Thanks, buddy.
You're welcome.
That was awesome.
Looking for a
I love it.
Zero shyness there.
That was amazing.
That was awesome.
Amazing. That's our best promo scripted. We've ever had right there.
Best promo. So I love you.
DJ Marshmallow, we're totally happy if you want to join us too.
Yeah, exactly. You can never eat us with us. That was so funny.
That was amazing.
Oh my gosh.
Okay. So, how's it been going with opening up a new bar?
That part's not as bad as people think it is. So, yes, there's a lot of work involved because I did it all myself. But I've always been warned about things like, ooh, the liquor license is going to be awful. Ooh, this inspection is going to be awful. With all of my headaches and the delays, none of it has had to do with the liquor license. None. I'm actually putting off the inspector because he wanted to come in and do final inspection. I went, well, I'm behind schedule. That's how quick it was going, which is unusual. So here in Ontario, especially if you're listening in the States.
Thank you.
So here in Ontario, of course, cannabis is now legal. So our liquor inspectors through the Alcohol Gaming Commission of Ontario also takes care of managing the cannabis stores, which is new. So there was a period of time, about six
Very
months
busy.
Or so, that they were swamped because all these new businesses that were approved are being opened. They have to go through inspections and all these new processes. So that was a whole, cannabis will be a whole other, that'll come up in season three. But it's one of those things that, because of that, I think a lot of those delays that people were complaining about were more about
we're getting the backlog
that,
of that.
And they just, because they were, backlog, as opposed to dealing with the regular stuff. So just so if you've never applied for one before, so these are things. So of course there's a fee. Always got to be a fee. You can pay for 1 year, you can pay for 2 years. And I just paid for 1 year to start off with. They send you this placard, they call it, which is like a paper poster. And it used to be an 8.5 by 11, and now it's like,
It used to be like a goldenrod sheet of paper.
Yeah, now it's black with white writing, and it's like 2 by 3. It's big. So you have to put it on the window of the new business for 28 days.
Which I did see that.
Yeah, and it has a phone number and stuff on it, so that if you have a complaint or anything else, that you can make a comment on that, or you can call if you don't want it in your neighborhood. Where I'm opening is all bars and restaurants around me anyways.
So the purpose of that is basically so that
to let
your
the neighbors
can bitch about the fact that they don't want a bar in their neighborhood. Gotcha. Okay.
Again, that's to protect them from allowing you to have the license and then having to deal with lawsuits and stuff later, right? Oh, you have to have to scale drawings of the bar layout, which I did. I'll put a link to the software that I used. It's a Smart Draw, which I was actually really pleased with. They actually have defaults in there for symbols and sizing for a lot of kitchen furniture, bar furniture, that kind of thing. So it made it a lot real easy because the application requires very specific, like
not just to scale, but you need to have this part outlined, where the license, where the people are going to be,
where
the storage
is
going to be, where the kitchen's going to be, if there's a outside patio areas, everything. And they actually have examples on this website to look for, but it's got to be the same way.
So I have a question for you. I don't know if you have the answer to this, but I'm going to ask it anyways. We see it a lot of places that you go, where certain areas are licensed and certain areas aren't. So in my brain, as someone who, you know, will never open a place up, but you know, someday in a magic land would. My brain says, license every space you possibly have, so you don't have to deal with these kinds of like having to have a barrier and a sign that says you can't bring your liquor past here. Are you aware of, is like, does it cost more the bigger the space? Is it?
Nope, it's the same fee. It may have to do with occupancy more than it has to do with the liquor license. So as an example, the space that I'm going to be leasing and eventually owning, it's about the same size as the Alibi Room. We've had been there previous episodes, which is across the street. And then again, it holds only about 35 people.
Yeah.
If that seems to be a magic number, and that's not set by the city, that's set by the province.
Yeah.
As soon as because I was originally thinking of taking some of the downstairs space and turning it into almost like a small, like a boardroom style thing for teaching classes and stuff, which would be separate. But to do that, now all of a sudden my occupancy has gone over 35, which means it's now considered a change in use. It's not the qualifications of what style of business it is. It's not a little bar tavern anymore. Now it's like a restaurant.
Got it.
So based on the number of people.
Oh, so is the number of people raised, then does that raise cost or does that raise
then all of a sudden it's additional exempt, different change. It's called change of use. And now it's new inspections, engineering, certain ceiling heights, all these other things have to change. So I scrapped that whole idea of the meeting room now. So now it's just the bar on its own. So that was part of that. Well, it's a good question though. You need a occupancy counts. You don't get to set the occupancy. That has to be done by a fire inspector as well as a city inspector that has to give you the occupancy. So I have two letters and they're two different numbers.
They're always different numbers.
They're always different. The city one gives me the overall one. The fire one gives me just patrons, not including staff. So, and then they said they usually, they'll give you a number in between as your final one.
Yeah.
So you have to get a fire compliance letter as well. So the inspector also needs to go through and give you all the list of things that may need to be changed with the space. This has to do with fire exits, making sure your extinguishers are there and up to date and have been checked. And yeah, the hood in the kitchen, because all the inspections have been done. Things are dated. How many exits there are based on the number of people, which is another issue. So there's that kind of thing has to get, so once you have that letter, that has to get sent in to the ministry as well. Health inspection, and that's just the initial one. That's not going to be your ongoing one for your regular health inspection. They need to have a health inspector come in and just sign off on that, yes, this space is okay for me holding this kind of a venue. And then they send a copy directly to the ministry and then give me a copy as well. And then there's a final inspection that's done by the actual liquor inspector. So I have never met this guy yet. But he'll come in like after all the other inspections are done and just prior to opening, just to, you know, to do a walkthrough. Just to make sure that my diagrams were exactly the way it was supposed to be. That I didn't change any of the layout stuff. The building space is already and looks exactly the way it is. That's what it's supposed to be.
So if you need to like change your furniture, do you need to like resubmit all this stuff?
No, if I had to change the layout... If I had to change the layout to the point where I was changing occupancy and decided not to do a bar and just do tables, that kind of thing, it may screw things up, but for the time being, it's okay. And then, so the bar design is something else. Oh, so another thing you have to organize is your POS system. Unless you want to be old school and just do cash register, old-fashioned cash register till...
Don't be old school.
Don't be old school. Okay, so POS system is required. You have equipment. Most of the new equipment that's required now are iPads. Mm-hmm. Those are all the newer ones they're suggesting. And you can actually, if you have a fairly new iPad, if it works with their software, you can use your own equipment, which is great. Of course, I didn't have, as much as I have iPads and everything else, they're not this...
Not new enough.
Not new enough. There's software costs, which are on a monthly basis, depending on how many units you're going to have. You need a merchant account, which is the company that's going to process credit card payments. Then, of course, you need a bank account, obviously. You need a separate Wi-Fi from the Wi-Fi you're going to have in the restaurant, right? Mm. And that's just because you don't want... 15 people watching movies sitting at the end of your bar and all of a sudden it's screwing up your payment system. That's not cool.
So what you're saying is I can't go into your bar, sit at the end of the bar and watch movies. Oh, I can, because you're going to have a separate Wi-Fi.
I'm going to have a separate Wi-Fi. So yes, you can come and watch movies on your device. But I will have no TVs in my bar.
And binge Netflix on my iPad you while can. You're serving
by all
me
means,
wine.
I got wine. I got wine. You bring your iPad. So then you need some setup time in advance, not just to create what your menu is going to be, but a lot of these new software include photos, yes. descriptions, the written stuff, the pricing, whether you're going to have specials. Pardon me. And then even the photos that you can actually show, or if you decide to use it, so where you can actually show the guests the venue as well.
Well, we've seen a number, like you go to, here in town, most of the all-you-can-eat sushi places now, you can order from an iPad, and you can actually see menus are happening on iPads where it goes directly into the point of sale. Mm-hmm. And it definitely doesn't eliminate your server, but it eliminates the possibility of error of the server misunderstanding the client. But then
correct.
The client could mess it up. Because
exactly. And they say, I didn't order that, but you touched the button. And anyways, that gives its own set of problems. I will not be letting people touch the iPads. That's another thing. Those damn things are too expensive.
Don't touch the iPads.
So then, of course, I had to, for the bar design itself, of course, if I want to maximize the occupancy, but based on the style that I want for service, so you got to figure out the flow of how you want people to be in your space.
And I think that's something that a lot of owners don't think about.
Yep.
Like that process of how people are going to come in, where they're going to go, what they're going to do. Once they've seated, you know, how do they access the washrooms? You know, if someone is in the washroom, can someone else still, you know, go across and do mm-hmm. what they need to do? And a lot of people, when they're starting a business, think about the guest experience, but more from their own perspective as opposed to the guest experience mm-hmm. itself. And you put in a lot of really thoughtful kind of touches for your guests.
Yeah, I'm a bit of a nerd. I'm not going to tell you all now because this is not a promo for the bar.
Yeah. But think about what your guests, because everybody's guests are different as well. Mm-hmm. And it's like, think about what your guest is going to do when they come to your establishment, how their flow of, are they going to go and sit at the bar for a bit? Are they going to go straight to the table, et cetera, et cetera?
And of course, for any business, the idea is to make money. Mm-hmm. So having things or designs or features within your space that it's going to help people stay long and spend money.
Encourage people to increase
their bills. That's exactly it. So that's one of the things. So yeah, so seating and table, where you're going to put it, decor, lighting's a big deal for me, because no woman wants to sit in a bar that they look awful in. Right? Harsh lighting, bad for Instagram.
Fair.
As we mentioned at the previous episode, we were talking about things that are, I think I made a post on that saying that there's no candid shots anymore.
No, they're all posed.
Mm-hmm. So bathrooms, the size of them, what amenities you're going to have in them, kitchen flow exam, is it going to be functional for what you need, for what you're planning to serve, seasonal things, if you need to change things based on, you know, snow, if you have snow in one area, cold weather, that kind of thing. You don't necessarily want tables directly at the front door. So there's all these things you have to worry about because your space is going to be serving guests at different times of the year, so you got to change that too.
Did you see the movie starring Tom Hanks about Ray Kroc and the original McDonald's?
Yes,
and I think the scene that got me the most was when he mapped out in the parking lot, literally measured out where the kitchen was going to be, and he put the team through, you're going to do this, then you're going to turn here, then you're going to do that. He literally mapped it all out on a to-scale model on the ground.
Yep.
So that they knew in the kitchen how they could make the most efficient way to make their product. And that was something, again,
because
that we never think about.
Because it needed to be fast and it needed to be consistent. And that was why McDonald's is so famous today.
But, you know, but it's still something that, you know, we may not do on the same scale when we're opening a space, because sometimes we're getting a kitchen that already exists. But still, think about where you're putting things based on how that flow is going to work.
And or, because as an example, so the place that I'm buying has its own kitchen, which is already installed, and it's a high-end commercial kitchen, but the way that it's designed, I'm actually changing the menu service style and how I'm doing things that's going to be functional for that kitchen, because
exactly.
It's too difficult to move things. So it's just a matter of being aware of that. Staffing is always a thing, because people are a big deal. I have a full training plan. Of course, I do teach servers and restaurants and wine people how to do their jobs better and make more money. I kind of do that already, so the fact that if I'm adamant about making sure, I used to overly train my staff for the catering business anyways, I'm going to do exactly the same thing for the bar. And none of this 5 minutes before you come in and here's where everything is and here's your apron. No, not my joint.
No.
Because not only does it make a better guest experience, it also makes a better experience for your staff, that they feel confident, they feel knowledgeable. I think I told you about I went to a local restaurant and the poor girl was sent over to me. I ordered a bottle of wine. And it was the very first time she's ever opened a bottle.
And you showed her how to open it.
And I had to show her, and this is not the first time this has happened.
Well, we, at one point, I think we opened a bottle of bubbles for someone at a restaurant once.
Yep. And it bothers me that something as simple as opening a bottle of wine was never shown to her, and that was not her first day.
Yeah.
That bothered me. So, anyways, it's not going to be, considering a wine bar, you're better well to have a bottle of wine. So opening, closing procedures I had to write out. I'm still working on finishing those things. The soft opening, of course, is a good training ground for your staff just to get a feel of how the whole evening is going to go. That's where you basically thank family, friends, key business associates, maybe some suppliers, that kind of thing that you want to.
Inviting people to come and order from the menu and experience it so your staff have a way to practice it with a forgiving crowd.
Correct, exactly. People who are going to cheer you on regardless of how bad it turns out.
Exactly.
If you decide you want to do any incentives and bonuses and that kind of thing, give some thought on that in advance because that'll affect how your payroll, which affects your cash flow, to make sure again at the day. If you don't make money, you're not open and everybody loses, right? And then last one was a food service. Again, you have to figure out who your suppliers are going to be based on what your recipes, what your food you're going to serve. Costing out your recipes, really cool. I'll give you a link to the one that I'm using right now to just to cost out each recipe. So I actually use two different software programs. One of them is just to house the recipes that I can actually scale easily.
Nice.
And I can actually import from things I find online without me having to type things out.
Oh, cool.
Which is very cool. And it actually copies on my phone and iPad, so I can do something on my laptop at home, and then I have lists, it exports it to my reminders, all that kind of stuff, which is great. But then it doesn't do the exact costing like another software program I used to use years ago. So I found another one that now just the recipes that I need costing for, I'm entering it into this, and I paid monthly for this one. Anyways, it's a lot of work. But at least I'll have an actual costing so they can make sure that, again, that each dish is profitable or that I'm making my average 30 to 35% margin overall. Which dishes they're going to be on, service style, portion sizes, and then a plan of how I want the food to be served, whether it's going to be served from the bar, whether it's going to be served from the kitchen, whether it's something that people are sort of snacking, it's at the table, those kind of things you have to keep in mind. And then the bar service will be the same thing. You're looking at suppliers' costing, whether it's by the glass, by the bottle. What else are you going to serve besides wine in the wine bar? I'm being very snobby and adamant. You cannot come in and get a draft beer in my place. This is a wine bar. It'll be wine. I will have a couple of options for imported bottled beer, that kind of thing, for people who don't want it, or if you're bringing guests. Sparkling waters.
Or a couple of wine or champagne-based cocktails.
Yeah, and sparkling cocktails, it can be whether it's alcohol or non-alcoholic. Mm-hmm. So this way I have some options that way. But aside from that, it's all focused on the wine. Mm-hmm. You can go and get a beer anywhere else.
Yeah.
And this is a big beer city, so I'm not really concerned about that. And then, of course, which glassware do I need for that? I also have to worry about glassware for pour consistency, because if I have 15 different styles of glasses, that it's more likely that 3 ounce pour is going to be different in each one, and difference between a 3 and 4 ounces is the difference. So then the service style, and then the service style and the plan again, just on how you want to do that. Okay, so that was my nutshell. I'm not going to go into details again. I don't like this. I didn't want this show to be about I'm promoting the bar. That's not what this is. This was more about. People are always asking about opening a business, and I've always been very aware and understanding of other business owners who I know what it's like to open a business and to be self-employed and to work those long hours and holidays and the expenses and the stress that can come with those kind of things. And I find that there's still a lot of people who may not know what goes into it in the behind the scenes just to get that place open, that they don't. I think if you hear all of the stuff that they're going through, when you do finally see them open, it may open your eyes a little bit more. And so, it make you a little more appreciative of all they're going through and kind of give them a break if something's not exactly perfect when they open.
So here's the thing, right? So if you're, Cynthia sitting here having a margarita going, I make a really great margarita, I should open a margarita bar. I think the reality is...
I think you should open a margarita bar.
Right? Right? Let's just do that.
Uh-huh.
Well, I've got, what do I call my... No, it's a mojito deck. So I've got a martini room in my room, in my house, and I've got a mojito deck. I might need a margarita pool next, mm-hmm. I think. Anyways, but I think it's more of like a buyer beware, or recognize when you're going into business, it's not just a matter of putting out some great food on a plate one day or making a really good cocktail, that there's a lot behind it. You know, reach out to your local chamber of commerce, your local business development center. There are programs, there are professionals out there that if this, everything that Stephanie just described was so daunting, you're like, forget this, I'm not doing it. That's probably all right, because that's a lot of stuff to take on.
But there's a lot of people there to help
you. But there are a lot of programs that you can get involved with to make sure that you are preparing the required paperwork, having a good solid business plan. There are business plan consultants and programs that will help you write a business plan so mm-hmm. that you can take it to the bank. The reality is, when people take business plans to the bank for financing, it's a lot harder to get money for a restaurant than it is to get money for other things. And that comes to people who are really great at their craft but not so good at the business side of things. So it's important to have that balance when you're going to open a new business.
Banks don't like lending money to food service businesses.
No. I think it boils down to tastes are fickle, and there are so many details.
And it's a risk.
There are so many details in a food service business as compared to other businesses that the risk is much higher to the bank.
Which is a lot of why a lot of restaurant owners sometimes gravitate towards franchises, because the franchise has already figured out all of those steps for you. They've made it easy. They've already figured out what menus are working, what food items are working, and that kind of thing. So it's just a safer bet. You're paying more money up front for it. You may not get as many profits right off the bat. However, that's one of the reasons that people tend to gravitate towards a franchise to start off with. So that's one of my little pet peeves too. Do not knock franchises.
Well, a lot of franchises are locally owned and operated,
that's
right?
Correct. And that's what I always bother. Just because it is a big name franchise does not mean that it is not owned by somebody locally in your own town, not owned by them, managed by them, and they might be just paying a certain percentage of their profits to their head office to be able to use that name, use those menu items, that kind of thing. They're not working any less. They're not spending any less money.
It's not like the money's all going out of town and not supporting local.
Exactly. So just keep that in mind, that anyone working in the food service or travel industry, same thing with hotels, same idea. I think that's it for me. I wasn't inventing. I'm still having margaritas, so I'm good.
You're good?
Yeah.
So we're changing our schedule now?
Anyways, I should be open by November 2nd, which comes into the schedule thing. The first week is November. Yeah, not necessarily that day.
Yeah, so we're moving to a two-week schedule, as we've heard before, which means our next episode will be on Saturday, October the 5th.
Correct.
And we are delaying our season 3 launch to closer to my birthday, so it will air on Sunday, November 2nd. Uh-huh. So stay tuned, check out our Facebook and our Instagram and the like to find out when we'll have our launch party locally, because those are always fun to attend. Mm-hmm. And you can grab your tickets if you're in Sudbury that week.
Yeah, so we always do like a big party. We may have some guests. There'll be samples and all that kind
prizes.
Of stuff.
Usually prizes.
Mm-hmm. We always have prizes.
We like prizes.
Mm-hmm. So, I think that's about it. So I'll have the details on that, but I'll have the links to, I'm gonna type out all of these little notes that I did. So things to look out for when you're going to be opening up a licensed establishment, just that you have a little checklist to get yourself started. And then maybe some of the links that I used for things like the software costing, all that kind of thing. Things that maybe it can help so that if you decide you want to start your own business, but didn't know all the things that you may have to look at, maybe it might something to give you motivation to do something for, you can start now and open in 2020.
Done and done. In the meantime, rate and subscribe on iTunes or your favorite podcast. And you can also subscribe to our YouTube channel, as our young friend Talem explained earlier.
Our future YouTube star.
I love it.
Exactly. From all of us here at Flag Flavor, looking forward to seeing you in season 3.
Cheers.
Cheers. Thanks so much for watching this video. We love putting it together. It's so much fun. All of our favorite things, good food, good drinks, a lot of travel talk, and we put it all together in one fun show. So make sure you follow us here, click on the videos below, follow, subscribe, and find us on your favorite podcast player. We'll see you on our next trip.